So basically, I will present some work, some joint work with Daniel Benkin, about 20 years of work, in between 15 years and 20 years of work with him, and with Jean-Marc Goyard and Monica Tapia, which is on topological information and higher order statistical structure, and some mathematical foundations of information and deep learning, I hope. So basically, the question are how to define and quantify pattern structures in complex data and statistical interaction in high dimensions, which is multivariate. How to synthesize the main theories of neuroscience, neural coding, epigenetic learning, and so on. And how to characterize and quantify multiple energy minima or diversity in complex data. And if it's possible to draw some mathematical foundations of deep neural networks. Notably, if we can find some constraint structure of deep neural networks with cohomological constraints. So I remember the foundations of probability by Kolmogorov, which stated that the most important concept in probability is independence, and that the most important problem in life science is to know whether real events are independent or not. And then at the end of his life, he stated that the real substance of entropy holds under very weak, purely combinatorial assumptions, and that information theory must precede probability theory and not be based on it. And by essence, the foundation of the discipline has a finite combinatorial character. So we'll see that it is exactly the finite combinatorial character which we will be present here. So I remember the main functions that I will use is the usual Shannon entropy function, which is the sum of pi log of pi, and the k-joint entropy, which is the same with the joint probability law. And the conditional entropy, all those are linked by the chain rule, the usual chain rule of information, which is fundamental. And they are represented using three kinds of equivalent representation: the Venn diagram, where the joint is the equivalent to the union, a semi lattice of unions, where the first rank is the single variables, the second rank is pairwise variable, the triplet is the third rank. And on this, we can identify each conditional information with each edge of the lattice. And the third one, which will be the simplicial representation, which is where the edge, which are basically triangles in n dimensions, where the edge are the marginals, where the vertices are the marginal, the edge are the pairs, the triplets are the triangles, quadruplets, tetrahedron, and so on. Basically, we can make the same with mutual informations. And the pairwise mutual information is defined as usual. Then the k multivariate mutual information is defined as an alternated sum of entropies. For example, the I3, the triplet is the sum of the marginals minus the pairs plus the triplets. And we have also the conditional mutual information that can be defined such that we obtain a similar chain rule of mutual informations. So basically, the mutual information behaves like intersection in the Venn diagrams. They have the same semi-lattice representation of mids, where the conditional mutual information also plays the role of is in one-to-one correspondence with the edges, and we can represent it also as simplices. So the other important quantities is a total correlation that you probably know as integrated information also. Which is a KL divergence, also always positive, and which is the sum of the marginals minus the total joint entropies. Okay, so there was a very nice theorem of Ukyoting that formalized what I presented before, is that the information functions are in bijection with finite additive measurable functions with a union, intersection, and complement, which correspond to the in one-to-one correspondence with the joint, mutual, and conditional information respectively. And this makes information functions a ring of functions, which is a very nice mathematical object. So what do they quantify? They quantify pairwise. It is long known that pairwise mutual information quantify independence. So basically, two variables are independent if and only if the pairwise is zero, and they generalize the correlation coefficient to non-linear relations. For instance, here represented for two variable case with Gaussian, the correlation coefficient and the mutual information give this almost the same results, whereas for non-linear relations, only the mutual information quantifies the interaction. So this generalized to k multivariate case. So for n variables to be mutually independent, it has to be necessary and sufficient condition is that all the mutual information all the mutual information vanishes. So there are 2n - n - 1 functions that has to vanish. And for comparison, the total correlation is really a total. I mean, it's a global correlation, and it is sufficient that only the n rank variable vanishes. So in fact, conditional independence Markov chains are also characterized uniquely in terms of conditional information. And I gave it an example of the theorem of Huq-Thing that variables from 0 to n plus 1 form a Markov chain if and only if all the mutual informations are equal to the pairwise mutual information in between x0 and xn plus 1. So as a take-home message, the information probability and probability theory are a single and inseparable theory. It's not, they are basically information quantifies probability dependencies. All usual statistical forms of statistical independencies are characterized and quantified in information theory, including Markov chains. And the K-mutual information provides some refined statistical independence, which can be quantified at all degree at all dimensions and degrees. So now, what is the cohomology and the homology? It's about a simplex adjoint generalization of triangles in n dimensions. So basically, here you will each vertices will represent a variable, a random variable, or a neuron for in the binary case. And you see that the one simplex is just an edge with the boundaries vertices. Two simplex is a triangle. Three simplex is a tetrahedron, and so on. And basically, I give the combinatorial semi-lattice representation of those corresponding to those simplex here, which is the binomial combinatory. It's usual, very classical. So now, what is a simplicial complex? It is it has to be seen as an algebraic sum of those simplices. And I represent here one complex, which is the definition of a graph or a network, usual graph or a network, you should understand it as a usual graph, a neural network for binary random variables. And with the representation here, a three-dimensional complex, with the representation as a poset, partially ordered set within the lattice. So homology and cohomology. Homology is just a sequence of chains going from high dimensional to low dimensional, where the operator that goes from one dimension to lower dimension, so basically it's a reduction dimension, is a boundary operator, which is usually a partial a differential operator. Everything goes in the other way, which is in the dual space for cohomology. It goes from low dimensions to high dimensions, and the chain becomes co-chains, complex becomes co-complex, and so on, and boundary becomes co-boundaries. So to the work with Beneklin, we published the first result, but it was we already worked for a long time for this in 2015. And it is based, the random variables are considered in a much broader case of a lattice of partitions. So a partition is a random variable, and it is which gives equivalence class per partition of the atomic probabilities. And then we define joint variables as the less fine partition that is finer than the two variables. So this is a very general setting, and this setting we define the conditioning as an action, and we define the complex of random variables and complex of measurable functions of those variables, such that we obtain a sequence like this. The general the boundary operator, which makes the dimension reduction dimension increase in the cohomology, is a very general one. I won't go in detail, but the first result is that if you compute this co-boundary in the first degree, first dimension, let's say, we obtain that the co-cycle condition, a cycle is just when you have no boundary. So a cycle has no boundary by definition. It is the boundary equals zero. Then you obtain exactly the chain rule of information. And with the chain rule of information, you can derive uniquely entropy. So we obtained that entropy is the first class, is the first class of cohomology, and that's the main theorem. We also obtained that the K-mutual information are K minus one boundaries, co-boundaries in this case. So basically, the take-home message is that information quantifies multivariate statistical dependencies, obstruction to factorization of variables. And the information theory as foundations in topology, I mean, the main object, the co-boundary operator and the chain rules are the same, given the good setting on random variables. And the generalization and it generalized to KL divergence, cross entropy, Salis entropy, differential entropies. And I recommend that you read the thesis of Juan Pablo Vigneault about this. So the mathematical foundations go very deep and are still at study. For application, we go to much simpler case, which is less combinatorics, which is the simplicial case I presented before with binomial lattice and the Boolean lattice. And the consequence is that we can miss some statistical dependencies. And so we use, and about free energy and n-body interaction, we define the internal energy as the sum of the marginals, single variable marginals, whereas the free energy is the total correlation, which is always positive Kullback. And then the mutual information quantifies the contribution of the K-body interactions to the free energy. With this identification, we cover the usual isotherm thermodynamic relation and Gibbs distributions for in special case. And we recover the usual entropy equals the internal energy minus the free energy. The internal, we represent the result as a landscapes, which is basically as a function of the number of variables in abscissa and the value of entropy, the joint entropy in ordinate or mutual information in ordinate. So it's there. So we draw the single variable pair triplets and so on and so on, and we can define passes as piecewise linear functions on these diagrams, and the slope of these passes is exactly minus the conditional mutual information. So the symmetry, so the set of paths is exactly in one-to-one correspondence with the symmetric group, and we can identify any pass with all passes with a given permutation, and they are also in one-to-one correspondence with stochastic processes. If we identify the indices with time, there is one all each passes correspond to one possible stochastic process. We can define positive information patch, which are strictly decreasing passes of information that goes down with the conditional mutual information, which are positive. And when it's rich and they go to a minima of conditional mutual information, which reaches to a zero of conditional mutual information, conditional independence criterion. And this describes a kind of minimum free energy complex. And this gives where to stop the path to give the complex. Another very, very nice interpretation, homotopical interpretation of synergy is that it provides some links or knots, a kind of knots. It means that, for instance, I give you the example of a multivariate triple binary variables. On the probability simplex, seventh probability simplex, it has two minima, which is equals to minus one bit, which is usually defining a synergy. And for this trip, and for the all pairs are fully independent, while there is a minus negative interaction between both, which is purely emergent and cannot be detected by any mean here. I represented the data space, for instance, of those configurations. And you see that whenever you project into a two-dimensional subspace, you obtain the uniform distribution and fully random. So it's purely emergent. And this generalized to K links. So about neuroscience, you know probably the story as good as me. The story started with the idea that understanding is compressing and efficient coding hypothesis by Atneev, notably, which stated that the goal of sensory perception is to extract the redundancies and to find the most compressed representation of the environment, and that any kind of symmetry and invariance are information redundancies. So this is it. And from the neural network point of view, it was remained the work of Laughlin on information mutual information maximization as an adaptation and learning rule. But also the Hopfield network and Boltzmann machine represent random variables as a recurrent network within which we can define an energy landscape and entropy where you can find the critical points which are the minimum, which correspond to some minima of energy within this stuff. I won't go into detail and to Linsker's story about this. And all in this works,
Pierre, sorry to interrupt. 2 minutes you have, just a reminder, okay?
Okay. Well, I have almost finished. So basically, we apply to gene expression in dopaminergic neurons, to give you one example. So basically, you have non-dopaminergic and dopaminergic neurons for 41 genes. And I will go just if you take 10 dopaminergic neurons and 10 non-dopaminergic neurons, and you compute the energy, the mutual information landscape, you see that color coding the number of at 10 k-uplets that are present for a given value. You observe that you have a single 10-uplets which identifies exactly the 10 dopaminergic neurons. And that the path of that identifies the complex identifies exactly also these 10 dopaminergic neurons, whereas the longest path also that identifies the non-dopaminergic neurons. And you can represent also the entropy and energy landscape on this. The total free energy could not be used for distinction on this case, but it's not always the case. So and now on the interaction in between array expression RNA, we could recover the metabolic chain of dopaminergic neurons as co-expressed neurons, whereas the minimum negative one identified differentially expressed genes with a spatial difference, notably. So basically, we'll finish on the unsupervised and supervised way of seeing the stuff, which is probably the most promising way. The Poincaré-Shannon machine is that if you identify the previous lattice with a network feed-forward network, where the first layer is the single variable, the second layer is the two variables, the third layer is the third variables, and so on. Then the learning goes from the lattice to the complex I presented before with a forward propagation rule, which is imposed by the cohomology direction, which is a differential operator, and so on and so on. So you can make the supervised case of this, considering only variables that are related to the label input. And before training, we have the same kind of sublattice. And then you select only the variables which are correlated to the label input which are inside. And this is implemented in some cases. For example, for images like digits, we identify the maximum of triplet information identifies the image like three. For quadruplets, image like three, and so on. And whereas the minima somehow interface the most different. And this is in InfoTopo module, GitHub InfoTopo module that is shared and currently developed. So conclusion, homology formalized and general networks are complex structures beyond pairwise statistics and allows to go from complex network to homological complex. We have some hope to find a very, very nice theory because cohomology, topology is very nice. In fact, foundations for supervised and unsupervised learning, where neural networks are seen as a co-chain complex. And we have encouraging data to further go in this way. So, but there is a lot of programmation to go at the level of stay at the PyTorch and the TensorFlow level at the moment. So that's it. And we can generalize communication channel to n channels of the informations.